Ron Fry's How to Study program.
How to Study, written by Ron Fry, read by Beverly Butler
and David Cooper.
This How to Study program was originated by Ron Fry because he was convinced that schools were doing a lousy job of teaching kids how to study, which means they weren't teaching them how to learn. No one, it seemed, was picking up the slack. Believing that kids want desperately to learn, but will, without some help, find it easier to fail, the educator and writer came up with Ron Fry's How to Study series. All of it is now available on audio tape. The topics covered include improve your reading, manage your time, take notes, write papers, improve your memory, and ace any test. This audio tape, How to Study, is an overview of all the areas which are discussed in greater detail on each specific tape.
Learning how to study is really a long-term process. Once you undertake the journey, you will be surprised at the number of landmarks, pathways, side streets, and road signs you'll find. Even after you've transformed yourself into a better student than you'd ever hoped to be, you'll inevitably find one more signpost that offers new information, one more pathway that leads you in an interesting new direction. Consider learning how to study a lifelong process, and be ready to modify anything you're doing as you learn another method. This is especially important right from the start when you consider your overall study strategies, how long you study per night, how long you work on a particular subject, how often you schedule breaks will vary considerably depending on how well you were doing before you heard this tape, how far you have to go, how interested you are in getting there, how involved you are in other activities, the time of day, your general health. Are you getting the idea? It gets more complicated. What's your study sequence? Hardest assignments first? Easiest? Longest? Shortest? Are you comfortable switching back and forth from one to another, or do you need to focus on a single assignment from start to finish? This gets even more difficult, believe it or not, when you consider that the tasks themselves may have a great effect on your schedule. 15-minute study unit increments might work well for you most of the time, though half an hour is an ideal unit for most of you. An hour only for those of you who can work that long without a break, or who have assignments that traditionally take that long to complete.
On the other hand, you may have no problem at all working on long projects in fits and starts, 15 or 20 minutes at a time, without needing to retrace your steps each time you pick it up again. What's the lesson in all of this? Figure out what works for you and keep on doing it. One of the key secrets for acing a test is to read the instructions before you start. This helps you avoid the poor grade, not to mention the frustration and embarrassment that results from trying to answer all 6 essay questions in an hour when you are only supposed to pick 3. Tests aren't the only time reading the instructions is important. Many teachers have their own rules and regulations about turning in homework assignments, preparing papers, name in upper right-hand corner, double-spaced, 1-inch margins all around, etc., or projects, reporting lab results, and so on, and it's just as important to follow these instructions and just as devastating if you don't. The development of good study skills is the highway to your goals, whatever they are. No matter how hard you have to work or how much adversity you have to overcome along the way, the journey will indeed be worth it. How do you make setting goals a part of your life? Here are some hints. 1. Be realistic when you set your goals. Don't aim too high or low, and don't be particularly concerned when, not if, you have to make adjustments along the way. 2. Be realistic about your expectations. An improved understanding of a subject you have little aptitude for is preferable to getting hopelessly bogged down if total mastery of the subject is just not in the cards. 3. Beware the Goldilocks conundrum. Despite the previous 2 points, you can be overly realistic, too ready to sigh and give up just because something is just too hot or too cold. There's a fine line between aiming too high and feeling miserable when you don't come close, aiming too low and never achieving your potential, and finding the path that's right for you. 4. Concentrate on areas that offer the best chance for improvement. Unexpected successes can do wonders for your confidence and might make it possible for you to achieve more than you thought in other areas. 5. Monitor your achievements and keep resetting your goals. Daily, weekly, monthly, yearly, ask yourself how you've done and where you'd like to go now. Use rewards as artificial motivators. The way you decide to use a reward system depends on how much help you need getting motivated to study. However, most schoolwork can be spurred along by the promise of little rewards along the way. If the task is especially tedious or difficult, make the rewards more frequent so that motivation doesn't sag. As a general rule, the size of the reward should match the difficulty of the task. For an hour of reading, promise yourself a 10-minute walk. For completion of a rough draft for a big assignment, treat yourself to a movie. In trying to motivate yourself, do you tend to use the carrot or the stick? Positive and negative thoughts can both motivate. The following are examples of negative thoughts that students have used to motivate themselves. 1. If I don't get a good mark on this test, there goes my grade. 2. If I don't finish this assignment, I'll have to miss the party. 3. If I blow this college entrance exam, my future is shot. 4. I'll be forced to go to summer school if I don't do well in this class. Now, here are some examples of positive thoughts that students have used to motivate themselves. 1. For every hour of solid study, I get to listen to 2 songs on my new CD. 2. If I get this assignment done early, I'll be able to go skiing Friday. 3. If I earn an A in this class, I'll reward myself with a weekend at the beach. 4. If I do well in these courses, my chances for grad school are excellent. There's nothing inherently wrong with using negative consequences to turn your failures into successes, but you should learn to turn your failures into successes. This will keep your attitude positive and keep the wind in your sails. Focusing on the positive helps you feel good about yourself and provides excitement and motivation for study. Most of us grow up automatically studying alone, but don't underestimate the positive effect studying with 1 or 2 friends can have on your mastery of schoolwork and on your grades. Consider the idea of a study group. The idea is simple. You find a small group of like-minded students, 4 to 6 seems to be an optimal number, and share notes, question each other, prepare for tests together. To be effective, obviously, the students you pick to be in your group should share all, or at least most, of your classes. Search out students who are smarter than you, but not too much smarter. If they're on a level far beyond your own, you'll soon be left in the dust and be more discouraged than ever. On the other hand, if you choose students who are too far beneath your level, you may enjoy being the brain of the bunch, but miss the point of the group, the challenge of other minds to spur you on. Study groups can be organized in a variety of ways. Each member could be assigned primary responsibility for a single class, including preparing detailed notes from lectures and discussion groups. If supplementary reading is recommended but not required, that person could be responsible for doing all such reading and preparing detailed summaries. Alternatively, everybody can be responsible for his or her own notes, but the group can act as an ad hoc discussion group, refining your understanding of key points, working on problems together, questioning each other, practicing for tests, and so on. Even if you find only 1 or 2 other students willing to work with you, such cooperation will be invaluable. It could prove especially useful in preparing for major exams as long as you clearly decide early the exact requirements and assignments of each student. You never want the feeling to emerge that someone is trying to ride the coattails of the others.
There's nothing more encouraging than finding out where you shine. It is the rare individual who is superior or even good in every subject. If you are, count your blessings. Most of us are a little better in one subject or another. Some of us simply like one subject more than another. And don't think that doesn't change your attitude toward it. Others are naturally gifted in one area, average in others. For example, Skill with numbers and spatial relations may come easily to you, but you may have no ear for music or languages, or you may find learning a language to be easy but not have the faintest clue why Pythagoras came up with his theorem, or why you should care. Presuming that most of us are good in one or two subjects, average or poor in others, we can react to this state of affairs in one of two ways. 1. Concentrate on those areas in which we're weakest and work to improve basic skills such as reading, memory, and organization so as to minimize our lack of particular talents. Or, 2. Concentrate exclusively on developing the particular skills we feel we like or need without worrying about the others at all. Most of you probably lean to the former solution. But then each of us has probably met someone who has taken the second course, strengthening his or her native-born talents and ignoring the rest. Such a person may have reached an incredible plateau of success in his or her field while being ignorant of literature, current affairs, art, or music. It's one way to get where you want to go, and may well be a path you choose. But you may be better advised to be thankful for whatever native-born talents you possess and use the gift as a two-edged sword. Shift some study time from those tasks easily achieved to those that you find more difficult. The balance you will see in your development will be well worth the effort. If you've never really thought about your aptitude for certain subjects, you might learn something if you ask yourself these questions. Which subject areas and courses do you like most? Which do you like least? In which courses do you get the best grades? And in which the worst grades? Use this list to organize your schedule, to take advantage of your own particular talents, and give added time to the subject areas that need most work. All college students and some high school students are able to pick and choose courses according to their own schedules, dislikes, goals, etc. The headiness of such freedom should be tempered with the common sense approach you're trying to develop through listening to this tape. Here are a few hints to help you along. 1. Whenever possible, consider the professor's reputation as you decide whether to select a particular course. Word gets around as to which professor's lectures are stimulating and rewarding, even if it isn't a subject you like. 2. Attempt to select classes so that your schedule is balanced on a weekly and even daily basis, though this will not always be possible or advisable. Try to leave an open hour or half hour between classes. It's ideal for review, post-class notes, quick trips to the library, and so on. 3. Try to alternate challenging classes with those that come more easily to you. Studying is a process of positive reinforcement. You'll need encouragement along the way. Avoid late evening or early morning classes, especially if such scheduling provides you with large gaps of downtime. Set a personal study pace and follow it. Place yourself on a study diet, the key rule of which is don't overeat. The landscape is littered with the shadows of unsuccessful students who failed in their pursuits not because they lacked the talent or motivation, but because they just overloaded on information and pressure. You can be successful without killing yourself. Nothing you will do as you pursue your studies will be as valuable as the reading skills you develop. They are your ultimate long-term learning tool. Presuming you agree, what do you do? There is a group of special sections found in nearly all textbooks and technical materials, in fact, in almost all books except novels, that contains a wealth of information and can help you glean more from your reading. Becoming familiar with this data will enrich your reading experience and often make it easier. Here's what to look for. The first page after the title page is usually the table of contents, a chapter-by-chapter list of the book's contents. Some are surprisingly detailed, listing every major point or topic covered in each chapter. The first prose section, the preface, is usually a description of what information you will find in the book. Authors may also use the preface to point out unique aspects of their books. Most introductions are an even more detailed overview of the book. They are chapter-by-chapter summaries, often included to give the reader a feel for the material to be covered. Footnotes may be found throughout the text and explained either at the bottom of the page on which they appear or in a special section at the back of the text. Footnotes may be used to cite sources of direct quotes or ideas, and/or to further explain a point, add information, etc. outside of the text. You may make it a habit to ferret out sources cited in this way for further reading. If a text tends to use an alarmingly high number of terms with which you may not be familiar, the considerate author will include a glossary, essentially an abridged dictionary that defines all such terms. The bibliography, usually at the end of the book, may include the source material the author used to research the textbook, a list of recommended reading, or both. It is usually organized alphabetically by subject, making it easy for you to go to your library and find more information on a specific topic. Appendices containing supplementary data or examples relating to subject matter covered in the text may also appear in the back of the book. The last thing in a book is usually the index, an alphabetical listing that references by page number every mention of a particular name, subject, topic, etc. in the text. Making it a habit to utilize all of these tools in your textbooks can only make your studying easier.
There are three ways of reading, depending on what you're trying to accomplish in a particular reading assignment and the kind of book involved. Knowing when to use each will make any assignment easier. 1. Quick reference reading focuses on seeking specific information that addresses a particular question or concern we might have. 2. Critical reading is used to discern ideas and concepts that require a thorough analysis. 3. Aesthetic or pleasure reading is for sheer entertainment or to appreciate an author's style and ability. The best way to begin any reading assignment is to skim first, then read for detail. Skim the pages to get an overall view of what information is included. Then, read the text carefully, word for word, and highlight the text and/or take notes in your notebook. While we're on the subject, by the way, let's set the record straight about skim and scan. There's a lot of confusion about the two words. Skim is to read quickly and superficially. Scan is to read carefully, but for a specific item. When you skim a reading selection, you're reading it in its entirety, though you're only hitting the highlights. When you scan it, you're reading it in detail, but only until you find what you're looking for. Newspapers make reading simple. Most newspaper articles are written in the pyramid format. The first paragraph makes the major point of the story. Succeeding paragraphs add more and more detail, filling out the pyramid. Gleaning the key news stories from a newspaper is as easy as reading the headlines and the first two or three paragraphs of each. Your textbooks are not always written to facilitate such an approach, but most of the authors probably make their key point of any paragraph in the first sentence of that paragraph. Succeeding sentences add details. In addition, most of your textbooks include helpful call-outs, those brief notes or headings in the outside margins of each page that summarize the topic covered in the paragraph or section, or include headings and subheadings to organize the material. These standard organizational tools should make your reading job simpler. The next time you have to read a history, geography, or similar text, try skimming the assigned pages first. To summarize the skimming process, read and be sure you understand the title or heading. Examine all the subheadings, illustrations, or graphics. Read thoroughly the introductory paragraphs, the summary at the end, and questions at chapter's end. Read the first sentence of every paragraph. This generally includes the main idea. Evaluate what you've gained from this process. Can you answer the questions at the end of the chapter? Could you intelligently participate in a class discussion of the material? Write a brief summary that capsulizes what you've learned from your skimming. Based on this evaluation, decide whether a more thorough reading is required. If so, go back for detail.
Read one section or chapter at a time. Do not go on to the next until you've completed this exercise. 1. Write definitions of any key terms you feel are essential to understanding the topic. 2. Write questions and answers you feel clarify the topic. 3. Write any questions for which you don't have answers, then make sure you find them through rereading, further research, or asking another student or your teacher. 4. Even if you still have unanswered questions, move on to the next section and complete numbers 1 to 3 for that section, and so on, until your reading assignment is complete. See if this method doesn't help you get a better handle on any assignment right from the start.
Math and science texts, or any highly technical ones like economics, require slightly different handling. You must understand one section before moving on to the next, since the next concept is usually based on the previous one. If there are sample problems, solve those that tie in with the section you've just read to make sure you understand the concepts imparted. If you still fail to grasp a key concept, equation, etc., start again and try again, but don't move on. You'll just be wasting your time. These texts really require such a slow, steady approach, even one with a lot of backtracking, or for that matter, a lot of wrong turns. Trial and error is an accepted method of scientific research. The key, though, is to make it informed trial and error, having a clear idea of where you're heading and learning from each error. Getting the right answer just because you eliminated every wrong one may be a very viable strategy for taking a test, but it's a lousy way to assure yourself you've actually learned something. There are some ways you can do better on technical subjects without the world's greatest memory, a lot of luck, or any radar. Whenever you can, translate formulas and numbers into words. To test your understanding, try to put your translation into different words. Even if you're not particularly visual, pictures can often help. Try translating a particularly vexing math problem into a drawing or diagram. Before you even get down to solving a problem, is there any way for you to estimate the answer, or at least to estimate the range within which the answer should fall? This is the easy way to at least make sure you wind up in the right ballpark.
Play around. There are often different paths to the same solution, or even equally valid solutions. If you find one, try to find others. This is a great way to increase your understanding of all the principles involved. When you are checking your calculations, try working backwards. Try to figure out what is being asked, what principles are involved, what information is important, and what's not. Teach someone else. Trying to explain mathematical concepts to someone else will quickly pinpoint what you really know or don't know. It's virtually impossible to get someone else, especially someone who is slower than you at this stuff, to understand if you don't.
André Gide said, "To read a writer is, for me, not merely to get an idea of what he says, but to go off with him and travel in his company." This is the kind of reading, aesthetic reading, you do for pure enjoyment, for diversion, for the appreciation of a certain literary style or tone. Of course, the great works from Animal Farm to Wuthering Heights can also be enjoyed as pleasure reading, but if you're reading for an English or literature class, you'll probably want to combine the aesthetic method with the critical method. Most fiction is an attempt to tell a story. There's a beginning in which characters and setting are introduced. There's a conflict or struggle that advances the story to a climax where the conflict is resolved. A final denouement, or winding up, unravels or clarifies the conclusion of the story. Your literature class will address all of these parts using literary terms that are often more confusing than helpful. The following are brief definitions of some of the more important ones. Plot: the order or sequence of the story, how it proceeds from opening through climax. Your ability to understand and appreciate literature depends on how well you follow the plot, the story. Characterization: the personalities or characters central to the story, the heroes, the heroines, and the villains. You'll want to identify the main characters of the story and their relationship to the struggle or conflict. Pay particular attention as to whether the characters are three-dimensional. Are they real and believable? Theme: the controlling message or subject of the story, the moral or idea that the author is using the plot and characters to communicate. Some examples: man's inhumanity to man, man's impotency in his environment, the corrupting influence of power, greed, and unrequited love. You need to discern this theme to really understand what it is the author wants to communicate. Setting: the time and place in which the story happens. This is especially important when reading an historical novel or one that takes you to another culture. Point of view: who is telling the story? Is it one of the central characters giving you flashbacks, or a first-person perspective? Or is it a third-person narrator offering commentary and observations on the characters, the setting, and the plot? This is the person who moves the story and gives it an overall tone.
The first step in reading literature is to familiarize yourself with these concepts. Then try to recognize them in each novel or short story. As you begin your reading, approach it first from an aesthetic standpoint. How does it make you feel? What do you think of the characters? Do you like them, hate them, relate to them? Second, make sure you know what's going on. This involves the plot or storyline and the development of the characters. On a chapter-by-chapter basis, you may find it helpful to keep a sheet of paper on which you can jot a sentence or two of the plot development and, if you wish, characters introduced, etc. For example, your notes on the first chapter of The Time Machine by H.G. Wells might read, "Time traveler, psychologist, the provincial mayor, the medical man, a very young man, and Philby are in the time traveler's house. It is a winter evening, fire is going. They talk about the geometry of four dimensions. Fourth dimension is time. T.T. declares he has discovered a way to move about in time and shows them experimental verification, small model for time machine. Took 2 years to make. Then disappears when activated. Claims it is traveling time. Announces that big machine is nearly ready, and when finished, he will use it for a journey in time." These notes are written out, but obviously you would not need to do that. Simply listing the points in outline fashion or noting key words would be sufficient. Does this adequately summarize the first chapter so you won't have to read it? Not really. Yes, it tells you the characters introduced and in bare-bones fashion what happened, but it leaves out all the details of the philosophical debate that begins the book, and most importantly, cannot possibly capture the mystery, foreboding, and thrill of entering an adventure that Wells manages to convey in this single chapter. It leaves out important information, like the themes carried out in the book, use of literary devices, etc. To truly summarize the chapter we've discussed, you might label the last paragraph plot, then include separate notes under the headings themes and literary. This would certainly help you both understand what you've read and simplify your review task to come. Remember, comprehending what you read is to a great extent more important than how fast you read, but there are several things you can do to improve your reading mechanics. Focus your attention and concentration. Eliminate outside distraction. Provide for an uncluttered, comfortable environment. Don't get hung up on single words or sentences, but do look up in the dictionary keywords that you must understand in order to grasp an entire concept. Try to understand overall concepts rather than attempting to understand every detail. And to increase comprehension, try to make the act of learning sequential. Comprehension is built by adding new knowledge to existing knowledge. Review and rethink at designated points in your reading. Test yourself to see if the import of the material is getting through. If things don't add up, discard your conclusions. Go back, reread, and try to find an alternate conclusion. Summarize what you've read, rephrasing it in your notes in your own words. Most importantly, keep reading at a speed that is comfortable for you. Simply keep practicing reading, which will increase your speed naturally.
We all have problems with time. We can't control it. We can't slow it down or speed it up. We can't save it. All we can do is decide how we're going to spend it. And time management skills aren't part of any standard academic curriculum. So take the time now to learn these techniques. They'll definitely buy you a lot more time. The first step is to identify your regular routine in detail. Start right now by charting in 15-minute increments how you spend every minute of every day right now, either for a day or two or an entire week. This is especially important if, like many people, you have huge pockets of time that seemingly disappear. Could you use an extra hour a day either for studying or for fun? Make better use of dead time and you'll find all the time you need. For example, learn how to do multiple tasks at the same time. Listen to a book on tape while you're working around the house. Practice vocabulary or math drills while you're driving. Have your kids, parents, or roommates quiz you for an upcoming test while you're doing dishes, vacuuming, or dusting. Always carry your calendar, notebooks, pens, and a textbook with you. You can get a phenomenal amount of reading or studying done while in line at the bank, in the library, or at the supermarket, or on a bus or train. Identify those items on your daily calendar, whatever their priority, that can be completed in 15 minutes or less. These are the ideal tasks to tackle at the laundromat, while waiting for a book to wind its way to your study cubicle, or while standing in line anywhere. And hours of additional time management tips are available from Ron Fry's audio tape, Manage Your Time, in his How to Study series. Regardless of a particular teacher's style or the classroom format he or she is using, your text is still the basis of the course and a key ingredient in your studying. You must read it, plus any other assigned books, before you get to class. You'll be lost if the professor decides for the first time ever to spend the entire period asking the students questions. You'll also find it harder to take clear and concise notes because you won't know what's in the text. If you're heading for a discussion group, how can you participate without your reading as a basis? Remember, this also includes reading any other books and articles previously assigned, plus completing any non-reading assignments, turning in a lab report, preparing a list of topics, or being ready to present your oral report, and preparing your attitude. Don't discount the importance of the way you approach each class mentally. Getting the most out of school in general, and any class in particular, depends in good measure on how ready you are to really take part in the process. You must be up for school, up for each class. It's not sufficient, even if you're otherwise well prepared, to just sit back and absorb the information. Learning requires your active participation every step of the way.
Tailor your note-taking to class format. The extent of note-taking required, as well as the importance of these notes to your success in the class, will depend largely on the format of the class. In a lecture, for example, your teacher might not even know your name. Consequently, your note-taking and listening skills are all you will have in your quest for top grades. In many non-lecture classes, you will find that discussion, mostly in the form of questions and answers, is actively encouraged. This dialogue serves to both confirm your knowledge and comprehension of specific subject matter and identify those areas in which you need work. Whatever the format in which you find yourself, participate in any discussion to the best of your ability. Most teachers consider class participation a key ingredient in the grades they mete out. No matter how many papers and tests you ace, if you never open your mouth in class, you may be surprised, but shouldn't be, to get less than an A. What if you're shy or just get numb whenever you're called on? Ask a question rather than taking part in the discussion. It's easier, and over time may help you break the ice and jump into the discussion. Most importantly, prepare and practice.
Fear of standing in front of a class or even of participating from the safety of your seat is, for many of you, really a symptom of lack of confidence. And lack of confidence stems from lack of preparation. The more prepared you are, if you know the material backwards and forwards, the more likely you will be, even want, to raise your hand and strut your stuff. Practicing with friends, parents, or relatives may also help. As soon as possible after your class, review your notes, fill in the blanks, mark down questions you need to research in your text or ask during the next class, and remember to mark any new assignments on your weekly calendar. If you tend to write fast and illegibly, now's a good time to rewrite your notes so they're readable, taking the opportunity to summarize as you go. In your attempt to develop lifelong study skills, you'll find yourself constantly using the resources of the library. Libraries contain the written record of humankind's brief stay on planet Earth. They stand unparalleled as one of our finest accomplishments, unchallenged as a reference and research source. The library presents a single well from which we can draw knowledge and material throughout our lifetimes without ever worrying about coming up dry. When you were younger, you probably relied solely on the encyclopedias in your school library when you had to write a report. If you're working on a paper, even if it's for graduate school, you may still want to read encyclopedias to get a general overview of your topic, but you need to turn to other sources for more detailed information. You should read books written by experts in the field you're researching. Find magazine and newspaper articles about your subject. Don't stop there. Pamphlets, brochures, government documents, specialized anthologies, films, and videos. These are just some of the other possible sources of information you can use for paper writing, research, enhancing your text reading, and preparing for oral reports. You should review as wide a variety of reference materials as possible. How do you find out whether anyone has written a magazine or newspaper article about your topic? How do you know if there are any government documents or pamphlets that might be of help? How do you locate those written by the experts reference books? You look in your library's publication indexes. These indexes list all of the articles, books, and other materials that have been published and/or are available in your library. Here are some of the major publication indexes. There are many, many others, so remember to ask your librarian for additional suggestions. 1. The Card Catalog. Still called a card catalog, even though nowadays it's all on computer. Books are indexed in 3 different ways: by subject, by author, and by title. 2. Newspaper indexes. Several large city newspapers provide an indexed list of all articles they have published. 3. Periodical indexes. To find out if any magazine articles have been published on your subject, go to a periodical index. The Reader's Guide to Periodical Literature, which indexes articles published in the most popular American magazines, may be one with which you're familiar. 4. Vertical file. Here's where you'll find pamphlets and brochures. 5. U.S. Documents Monthly Catalog. Useful for locating government publications. When you're searching for hard-to-find information, you may also want to check the following. 1. Special anthologies, almanacs, and encyclopedias. Providing more in-depth information than general encyclopedias, these are entire series devoted exclusively to specific topics. 2. Association directories. An association or organization related to your topic can be one of your most valuable sources of information. Often, such organizations have a historian who can provide you with extensive literature, or better yet, the names of experts you might interview. You can find their names and addresses here. Many libraries print a list of their resources and a map of where they can be found. What if yours doesn't? That's right. You ask your librarian for help.
Getting the right start is all important. Let's assume, for example, that you have to prepare a report on the latest attempts to combat apartheid and fit this effort into a historical perspective. Here's how you might approach the task. 1. Go to a dictionary and look up the term apartheid. Make certain you have a firm understanding of what this word means before you proceed any further. 2. Consult any one of the numerous leading encyclopedias you will find in your library: Britannica, Americana, Collier's, World Book, etc. Here you'll find an overview and historical perspective on the subject of these special racial laws. Encyclopedia entries are usually the most comprehensive and concise you will find. They cover so much territory and are so relatively up to date that they are an ideal big picture resource. 3. With overview in hand, you can start consulting the major indexes and directories your library has to develop a list of more specific resources. Of course, your card catalog or computer terminal will spew out listings for hundreds of other books on the general issue of apartheid or any related subject it touches, which you learned about while skimming pertinent sections of the above general resources: the African National Congress, Nelson and Winnie Mandela, Prime Minister Botha, Black Homelands, Archbishop Desmond Tutu, etc. What if you're uncomfortable in the library, an infrequent user, or simply find it a confusing place that's more trouble than it's worth? Developing any habit is just a matter of practice. If you want the library to become like a second home, it's every shelf a familiar friend, why not go to work there? Many libraries, smaller ones in particular, often offer opportunities for paid and volunteer work. Even if you work for free, this is an excellent way to learn the ins and outs of your library. The more comfortable you are, the more you know about the materials it contains and how to locate and use them, the more you will want to be there, and the more help you will be able to obtain from this great resource that is just waiting to welcome you. You will find yourself turning to the library as your starting place, for instance, when you are asked to prepare written reports. And it's going to happen, whether you like it or not. Sooner or later, you'll have to prepare written and/or oral reports for virtually every one of your classes. And if you're like most students, your reaction will be the same every time. Why me? What do I do? Where do I start? There is absolutely no reason to fear a written paper or oral report once you know the simple steps to take and rules to follow to complete it satisfactorily, once you realize that 90% of preparing a paper has nothing to do with writing or even with being able to write. Let's start with the fundamental rules that need to be emblazoned on your wall. 1. Always follow your teacher's directions to the letter. 2. Always hand in your paper on time. 3. Always hand in a clean and clear copy of your paper. 4. Always keep at least one copy of every paper you write. And 5. Never allow a single spelling or grammatical error in your papers. Your teacher's directions may include a general subject area, from which topic should be chosen, some aspect of Kennedy's presidency, an 18th century invention, a short story by Washington Irving, etc. Specific requirements regarding format, typed, double-spaced, include title page, do not include title page, etc. Suggested length, 10 to 15 typewritten pages. Other requirements, turn in general outline before topic is approved, get verbal okay on topic before proceeding, don't include quotes from other works longer than a single paragraph, other idiosyncrasies of your own teachers. Whatever his or her directions, follow them to the letter. High school teachers may be somewhat forgiving. There are those college professors who simply refuse to accept a paper that was not prepared as they instructed and gave the poor but wiser student an F for it without even reading it. If you are unsure of a specific requirement or if the suggested area of topics is unclear, it is your responsibility to talk to your teacher and clarify whatever points are confusing you. It is not a bad idea to choose 2 or 3 topics you'd like to write about and seek his or her preliminary approval, especially if the assignment seems particularly vague. There is no reason, short of catastrophic illness or life-threatening emergency, for you to ever be late with an assignment. Barring those, there is rarely an acceptable excuse for being late. Again, some teachers will refuse to accept a paper that is late. At best, they will do so, but mark you down for your lateness, perhaps turning an A paper into a B or worse. The content is what your teacher is looking for, and he or she will primarily be basing your grade on what you write, but presentation is important, so follow these simple rules. Never handwrite your paper. If you're using a word processor or word processing program on your computer, use a new ribbon in your dot matrix printer and/or check the toner cartridge of your laser printer. If you type or have someone else type your paper, use clean white bond and preferably a new carbon ribbon so that the images are crisp and clear. Unless otherwise instructed, always double space a typewritten paper. Use a simple typeface that is clear and easy to read. Avoid those that are too big, stretching a 5-page paper to 10, or too small and hard to read. Never use a fancy italic, modern, or any other ornate or hard-to-read typeface for the entire paper. There should be a number of helpful messages in your returned papers, which is why it's so important to retain them. What did your teacher have to say? Are there comments applicable to the paper you're writing now? Poor writing, lack of organization, lack of research, bad transitions between paragraphs, poor grammar or punctuation, misspellings? The more such comments, the more extensive the map your teacher has given you for your next paper, showing you right where to locate your A. If you got a low grade but there aren't any comments, shouldn't you have asked the teacher why you got such a poor grade? You may get the comments you need to make the next paper better. You will also be showing the teacher you actually care, which could help your grade the next time around.
As you tackle your assignment, you actually have three different jobs ahead of you. 1. You must search for information. First, you'll dig up all the facts you can about the subject. You will gather statistics, historical data, first-person accounts, and other information. You will read reference books, newspaper stories, magazine articles, scholarly journals, and other materials. You may watch a relevant video or film, even interview a live expert or two. As you do all of this, your role is like that of a reporter. Your job is to find out the truth. You must gather data with an unbiased eye. You can't discard or ignore information that doesn't fit in with your personal opinions or expectations. 2. You must analyze the data. Once you've gathered information, you must study all the data, again, from an objective viewpoint. Like a scientist evaluating the results of an experiment, you must review the evidence and decide what it means. You must draw a conclusion about your subject. 3. You must report your findings. You must share your newfound knowledge. You'll write an in-depth report and tell your readers what you have learned. The more complex a task, or the longer you need to complete it, the more important your organization becomes. By breaking down any paper writing project into a series of manageable steps, you'll start to feel less chaotic, hectic, and scared right away. Here are a few steps that, with some minor variations along the way, are common to virtually any written report or paper. 1. Do preliminary topic research. 2. Finalize your topic. 3. Carry out initial library research. 4. Prepare a general outline. 5. Do detailed library research. 6. Prepare detailed outline from note cards. 7. Write your first draft. 8. Do additional research if necessary. 9. Write your second draft. 10. Spell check and proofread. 11. Have someone else proofread. 12. Produce a final draft. 13. Proofread one last time. 14. Turn it in and collect your A. Create a work schedule. Get out your calendar. Find the date on which your paper is due. How many weeks till then? Plan to spend half of that time on research, the other half on writing. Now, block out set periods of time during each week to work on your paper. Schedule 2 or 3 hour chunks of work time rather than many short periods. As you make up your work schedule, set deadlines for completing various steps of your paper. You should plan on writing 2 or 3 drafts of your paper before you arrive at the final copy.
Week 1. Decide on topic and angle of your paper. Week 2. Make list of reference materials. Week 3. Read reference materials, take notes. Weeks 5 and 6. Do detailed outline, write first draft. Week 7. Edit paper, prepare bibliography. Week 8. Proofread paper, type final copy. Refer to your work schedule often and adjust your speed if you find yourself lagging behind. In some cases, your teacher will assign your topic. In others, your teacher will assign a general area of study, but you will have the freedom to pick a specific topic within that general area. There are some pitfalls you must avoid. Let's say you need to write a 15-page paper for your American history class and you decide your topic will be America's role in World War II. Can you really cover that in 15 pages? Not unless you simply rehash the high points a la your third-grade history book. You could write volumes on the subject many people have and have plenty left to say. Instead, you need to focus on a particular limited angle of your subject, such as The Role of the Women Air Force Service Pilots in World War II. By the same token, you must not get too narrow on your focus. Choose a subject that's too limited, and you might run out of things to say on the second page of your paper. The design of the Women Air Force Service Pilots insignia might make an interesting one- or two-page story. It won't fill 10 or 15 pages. Pick a topic that's too obscure, and you may find that little or no information has been written about it. In this case, you will have to conduct your own experiments, interview your own research subjects, and come up with your own original data. It may be wonderfully creative and a lot of fun to work in such original areas, but it can also be frustrating and stressful. Taking all of the above into consideration, do a little brainstorming now about possible topics for your paper. Don't stop with the first idea. Come up with several different possibilities.
Now for the start of your initial library research. Got your list? You need to do a little advance research. Scan your library's card catalog index and Reader's Guide to Periodical Literature or other publication indexes. See how many books and articles have been written about each topic on your possibilities list. Next, read a short background article or encyclopedia entry about each topic. With any luck at all, you should be left with at least one topic that looks like a good research subject. If two or more topics passed your preliminary research test, pick the one that interests you most. You're going to spend a lot of time learning about your subject. There's no rule that says you can't enjoy it. Once you've chosen the topic for your paper, you must develop a temporary thesis. The word thesis is a relative of hypothesis and means about the same thing, the central argument you will attempt to prove or disprove in your paper. A thesis statement is a one-sentence summary of your thesis, summing up the main point of your paper. Once you've developed your temporary thesis, give some thought as to how you might approach the subject in your paper. Jot down the various issues you plan to investigate. Come up with a brief, temporary outline of your paper showing the order in which you might discuss those issues. Don't worry too much about this outline. It'll be brief at best. It's simply a starting point for your research, a plan of attack. But don't skip this step either. It'll be a big help in organizing your research findings. To create a working bibliography, you'll need a supply of 3x5 index cards. You'll also use index cards when you take notes for your paper, so buy a big batch now. About 300 cards ought to suffice. While you're stocking up on index cards, pick up one of those little boxes designed to hold the cards. Put your name, address, and phone number on the file. If you lose it, some kind stranger can return it. Start a systematic search for any materials that might have information related to your paper. When you find a book, article, or other resource that looks promising, take out a blank note card. On the front of the card, write down the following information. In the upper right-hand corner of the card, the library call number, Dewey Decimal number, or Library of Congress number. Add any other detail that will help you locate the material on the library shelves. For example, science reading room, reference room, microfiche periodicals room. On the main part of the card, the author's name, if given, last name first name, middle name, or initial. Then the title of the article, if applicable, in quotation marks. Then the name of the book, magazine, newspaper, or other publication, underlined. In the upper left-hand corner of the card, number it. The first card you write will be number 1, the second number 2, and so on. At the bottom of the card, if you're going to be working in more than one library, write the name of the library. Also, write down the name of the index in which you found the resource in case you need to refer to it again. Do this for each potential source of information you find and put only one resource on each card. When you write your paper, you'll get all the information you need from your notes rather than from the original sources. Therefore, it's vital that you take careful and complete notes. What sort of information should you put on your notes? Anything related to your subject and especially to your thesis. This includes 1. General background information, names, dates, historical data, etc. 2. Research statistics. 3. Quotes by experts. 4. Definitions of technical terms. Be sure to record all of your notes on index cards. Let's say that you found a reference book that contains some information about your subject. Before you begin taking notes, get out the bibliography card for that book. First, check that all of the information on your card is correct. Is the title exactly as printed on the book? Is the author's name spelled correctly? Next, add any other information you will need to include in your final bibliography. The type of information you need to put on your bibliography card depends on the type of reference material and the bibliography format you're required to use. Once your bibliography card is finished, set it aside. Get out some blank index cards and start taking notes from your reference source. Follow these guidelines. Write one thought, idea, quote, or fact on each card, but never carry over a note to a second card. If you encounter a very large quote or string of data, you can write on both the front and back of a card if necessary, but never carry over a note to a second card. What if you simply can't fit the piece of information on one card? You're dealing with too much information at once. Break it down into two or more smaller pieces, then put each on a separate card. Write in your own words. Summarize key points about a paragraph or section in your own words. Avoid copying things word for word. Put quotation marks around any material copied verbatim, but you must copy each statement exactly as written in the original, every word, every comma, every period. You must also always put such direct quotes within quotation marks. As you finish each note card, do the following. In the upper left-hand corner of the card, write down the resource number of the corresponding bibliography card. This will remind you where you got the information. Below the resource number, write the page number or page numbers on which the information appeared. Get out your preliminary outline. Under which outline topic heading does the information on your note card seem to fit? Jot the appropriate topic letter in the upper right-hand corner of your note card. If you're not sure where the information fits into your outline, put an asterisk instead of a topic letter. Later, when you do a more detailed outline, you can try to fit these miscellaneous note cards into specific areas. Next to the topic letter, jot down a one- or two-word headline that describes the information on the card. When you finish taking notes from a particular resource, put a check mark on the bibliography card. This will let you know that you're done with that resource. Be sure that you transfer information accurately to your note cards. You need to be consistent. Always put the page number in the same place in the same manner. Ditto with the resource number, the topic heading, and the headline. Throughout your note-taking process, you may want to make some personal note cards, your own thoughts, ideas, or impressions about your subject or your thesis. Perhaps you've thought of a great introduction for your paper. Put it on a card. Or maybe you've thought of a personal experience that relates to your topic. Put it on a card. Write each thought on a separate note card as you have with information you've taken from other resources. Assign your note card a topic heading and a mini headline too. In the space where you would normally put the number of the resource, put your own initials. This will tell you later that you were the source of the information or thought.
It's time to organize your data. You need to decide if your temporary thesis is still on target. Once you have your final thesis, begin thinking about how you will organize your paper. This is where the note card system really pays off. Your note cards give you a great tool for organizing your paper. Get out all of your note cards. Number one, group together all of the cards that share the same outline topic letter, the letter in the right-hand corner of your note card. Two, put those different groups in order according to your temporary outline. Three, within each topic group, sort the cards further. Put together all of the cards that share the same headline, the two-word title in the upper right-hand corner of the note card. 4. Go through your miscellaneous topic cards, the ones you marked with an asterisk. Can you fit any of them into your existing topic groups? If you can, replace the asterisk with the topic letter. If you can't, put the card at the very back of your stack of cards. Your note cards now should be organized according to your preliminary outline. Take a few minutes to read through your note cards, beginning at the front of the stack and moving through to the back. What you are reading is a sketchy draft of your paper, the information you've collected in the order you plan to present it in your paper. Does that order make sense? Or would another arrangement work better? If necessary, revise your general outline according to the organizational decision you just made. However, don't change the letters that you have assigned to the topics in your outline. If you decide to put topic B first in your new outline, keep using the letter B in front of it. Otherwise, the topic letters on your note cards won't jibe with your outline. Next, go through each group of cards that share the same topic letter. Rearrange them so that they too follow the organizational pattern you choose. Flip through your note cards from front to back. See that? You've created a detailed outline without even knowing it. The topic letters on your note cards match the main topics of your outline. And those headlines on your note cards? They're the subtopics for your outline. Simply transfer your note card headlines to paper. They appear in your outline in the same order as they appear in your stack of cards. Some instructors require that you get your outline approved before going ahead with your paper. If you have to do this, find out the specific outline format you are to follow. You may need to use a specific numbering lettering format, such as Roman numerals instead of capital letters for topic headings. Creating your first draft will prove easier than you might anticipate. That's assuming you've done everything as instructed so far, taken good notes, organized your note cards, and prepared a detailed outline, etc. Good writing takes concentration and thought, and concentration and thought require quiet, and lots of it. You'll also need to have plenty of desk space so you can spread out your note cards in front of you. Your work areas should be well lit, and you should have a dictionary and thesaurus close at hand. If possible, work on a computer so that you can add, delete, and rearrange your words easily. Remember, at this
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.